Hello and welcome to the online learning session Bush Control Touch Scripts. Yeah, our online learning sessions take around 30 minutes. The focus is on a special topic or a selected function of a device. Today again, the Bush Control Touch with the function scripts. Yeah, my name is Thorsten Reibel from the ABB Competence Center Europe Smart Buildings. Martin Vichare is also present and he will do the session today. Yeah, we record the session as always and will publish later both the video but also the presentation. And still today I will send you at least the PDF of this presentation, but later you will get then the official feedback with the video as well. Good, I would hand over now to Martin. He will just continue just a moment.
Yeah, hello everyone. And thank you, Thorsten, for the introduction. Yeah, my name is Martin Vichari, and the topic for today is, as we heard, the Bush Control Touch and one special function, which are the scripts inside the Bush Control Touch. So I will try to give you an overview about what is possible and what functions we can realize here. Okay, so let's have a look at the agenda first of all. So first we will start with the basic of scripts, so how they are set up and where we can create them, where we can manage them, of course. And then we will have a look what commands are available, which values and functions we can use. And then we have the control structures, which are very important to create small programs here for the Control Touch. And last, we have some small examples for you to show you maybe what is possible and to give you an impression of what we can do with the scripts here. Good, so we have run now several online learning sessions about the Control Touch, in which we have showed you many functions of the Control Touch, and scripts are one of the functions, and this is the function we will talk mainly today about. So first of all, the question, what are scripts? So in general, we can say that scripts are small programs which can be created and used inside the Control Touch. And in the scripts, we can add different functions or commands to set up scenes or other important parts in our KNX project here. Important is also that the Control Touch supports two kinds of scripts. So we have on the one hand the native scripts, which is more or less the programming or the own programming code for the Control Touch. And we also have the Lua scripts, which is also a scripting language, but not a Control Touch specific one. So this language is also used by many other manufacturers. Today we will talk mainly about the native scripts of the Control Touch. So if you need more information about the Lua scripts, you can also search or Google it, and there you will find also many other information about Lua scripts. But today mainly we will talk about the native scripts. Okay, before we start with the code itself, what are typical use cases for scripts or for what can we use them? So first of all, we can of course optimize some KNX scenarios like wake up scenes in the morning, or we can create switch off delays, switch on delays, which is quite useful in some cases. So in general, we can say we can create also functions for actuators and for KNX devices, which are maybe not covered by the application itself. But here in some cases, we can create these functions with our scripts. Yeah, then we have, of course, the possibility to control UPnP audio devices. Here we also have an example later. Decoding status information could be one interesting use case. So here we also have an example in the end of the session. Yeah, and of course, many other things like alarm signals, light and music scenes, logic functions, and much more. Okay, so now the general setup for the scripts. So as you can see here on the right side, we have first of all the main editing box where we can write all commands and lines into it. And very helpful is here also the function to write comments to explain the code or just to have a clear structure for the code. So what you see here in green are comments, which just explain what do you do in this script, also for yourself, that you know later on what you have done here. Yeah, for each line we can put here now one command, so one comment or one command to set a byte, for example, to a percentage. More than one command in one line is not allowed. Yeah, the scripts are managed by the installer on the My Buildings portal. So with an expert account, you get access to the menu scripts where you can create and delete them. The end user itself will not have direct access to the scripts. You can only allow him to use the scripts in scenes, but he will not be possible to or not be able to create new scripts or edit them or something like this. This is only done by the expert or by the installer. Yeah, if you have created some scripts or you have adjusted them, you have to load the scripts into the control touch before you can use them. So they are mainly stored here online, and if you want to use them, you have to load them into the control touch. So here are then all scripts displayed which you have created, and if you load the configuration to the control touch, they will be also displayed locally. So to see them, we have to access first of all the control touch locally. So we can use the IP finder tool to find our control touch, or we, if we know the IP address, we can also of course access also directly. Then we call it, we put in our username and our password for the control touch. And here in the menu, you find many different settings like for scenes, time programs, and so on. And one menu is also available now for our scripts here. So when we click on this menu, we will find then all different scripts which are created and loaded into the control touch. And here we can now manually start them, restart them, stop them, or we can also activate and deactivate them. So this is very helpful if you want to test your scripts. Okay, back to the My Buildings portal, back to the script editor. We want to create a new script now. So what we did here is like we clicked on the create new script button. And this is then the script editor, which you see then for the first time. And we have here three parts. First, some main settings on the top left side. Then we have the command box, and we have the editing field where we have to put in now the commands and comments when we use them. So on the top left side, the basic settings, we can activate and deactivate the script here. We can give it a name. We can decide if the script should start automatically when the control touch is restarted. And we can decide if the script should be available in scenes and time switches for the end user. And last, you see here the type of the script. So here we have native scripts. If you use Lua scripts, then you would see here Lua. Okay, so this is the first part, so the basic settings for the script. The second part is, as I said, the editing box where we can put in all our commands that we need for our script. So here, of course, it would be very difficult to add all the commands manually without help. So therefore, we have on the top right side what you already saw, the command box. So of course you could theoretically also type the commands manually to the lines, or you just click on the command which you need, and this command will be automatically put in now to this box. So means, for example, I have added here first of all two comments, and with the next line I can search in the box now for a command. I just click on the command which I need. So here, for example, set byte component to value, and then this command will be automatically added then to my editor field. Okay, so what you also see here is that I have now the command, and you see that I have here a gray field which is called byte, and this gray field signalizes me that I can click on this field, on this gray field, and the system, the control touch, will show me then all different group addresses which are available and which has also the right data points. When I click here on the right field, you will see that on the in the command field here, the control touch will automatically switch then to bytes field, and you see I have here one group address which is called dimmer1, so I can just click here on the dimmer1 in the box and the group address will be automatically added to my script. One additional information may be here, you see the number next to the group address, which you see is like a numbering of all group addresses inside the control charge. So this is not a value or a name or something like this. This number 7 here is just the internal numbering for the group addresses. Okay, so we have added now the byte to the line. So you see now the byte dimmer1 is now added. And what is also very helpful now, I can directly click now here on save and check. And when I click on this button, the control touch will check now all lines if there are any mistakes in the structure. So when we check them here, we would see now that our line will turn red, as you see here, because we haven't set a correct value here now for the dimmer. So I can enter now 50 for 50%. We click again on save and check, and the line will be displayed then in black, so we know that the value is correct here. One very additional information here, as you see, the control touch usually expect a byte value between 0 and 255, but we have here one special situation in the control touch because the group address, the dimmer1 group address, which we have created in the control touch project, is the dimmer value. So it has the data point type 5.001, which is percentage value. So the control touch knows now here that we dim the light to 50% with this command. If you have a general one byte group address, then the data point type in the control touch is 5.010. And in this case, the control touch will expect a value between 0 and 255. Okay, so this is then the general setup, how we can create lines, how we can create our first small scripts. Okay, scripts has to be activated next, so the activation can be a trigger, for example. So here we create a trigger with an extra group address, and as soon as this group address has been changed, so this we are defining here in the trigger function, we have the group address start wake up script, and for each telegram which is sent here to this group address, we want to start the script wake up light, for example. Scripts can be also be activated by adding them to scenes or in time programs, as you can see here that every morning at 8 o'clock the wake up light starts. Or we can do what we can do is also that we can activate script by another script. Okay, so next I want to give you an overview about the possible commands and functions which are available here in the control touch scripts. Of course, we can't explain each function and command now in detail, but I will try to give you at least an overview about the possibilities in general. So first of all, we have the general commands. So typically to set a special component to a value. So here we have on the one hand the set command to have a direct switch more or less to a certain value. And we have the fade command. With the fade command, you can create, for example, a slow dimming up behavior, like in the example here on the bottom, where we fade a dimmer from 0 to 100% in different steps. So the first step to 10% in 11 seconds, then to 30% in 11 seconds, and so on. Here you could also, of course, use minutes, hours, or even days could be used here for the time. Yeah, then we have a read command, for example, to read the status of some components like valves, so this could be also used. Then next, we have some commands to control other scripts, so we can stop other scripts, we can restart them, or like in this example we have here, we could just deactivate other scripts from the installation, so this would be also possible to activate and deactivate other scripts, or just, as I said, to start a different script. Next, we have two delay functions. Why do we need this? So in general, the scripts are working like that, that when one line is finished or is executed, that the next line, the following line, will automatically execute it. But in some cases, in some use cases, you maybe want to create a delay for a turn on or turn off command. So here we have the wait function. So here in this example, that we wait 5 minutes, maybe when we leave the house, we wait 5 minutes, and then the one light in our installation will turn off then. Yeah, what else is possible? You can see that we can call scenes, we can override scenes with the learn scenario, or we can also call alarm functions from our control touch, and we can activate and deactivate also time profiles. And last, we have some execute commands. The first one to activate a network command, for example, if you have an IP camera which is listening to network commands to take a snapshot, for example, and one for UPnP devices. So here, like I used in my example for my Sonos device, of course, here for Sonos, we have the API integrated, so I don't really need the scripts, but maybe you have UPnP audio devices from other manufacturers, and there you could also, of course, use the script commands here. Good, so next, commands. So what can we use here? Values and calculation and so on. So what can we use here? So first of all, the values. Just in general, we already talked about values on the previous examples. So basically, this will be not new for you, but just to point out what a value is. So the value is always the number or the text which we can assign to a group address here in our scripts. Here in this example, we have a small timer function. We use the wait command and give the value of the group address to this wait command. So this is then a variable value which we use here, which can be sent maybe from the control touch. And with a 1-bit object start timer, we can start the script. And after the random time, we get an alert with the call command and the timer, which is also the 1-bit group address, is set to 0 again. So this as a small example, everything what we assign here, the 0 or the very the 2-byte object with the seconds, are here values for our script. A value don't have to be a fixed number or a fixed text. We can also use variables, as you saw. So to create a new variable, we have to select the dollar icon. Then we decide the name of the variable, and we give it a start value. The name of the variable is, of course, flexible and open. You can decide what you use here. It's, of course, for understanding the script, always easier to give it a speaking text, let's say, or a speaking name, which explains a little bit the task of this variable. Yeah, this variable can now be changed by mathematic functions, for example, and then we can write the group address with the new value which we have calculated, for example. So as I said, this is usually used in combination with mathematic calculations. So here you find all operations which are available. So basically all standard operations like plus, minus, divide, comparisons like smaller, greater, and so on. So this is all available. So these are the standard mathematical operations. We also have some mathematic functions which can be used. So not only the operations, also real functions. And these are the functions which are available. So we have, for example, round, floor, seal. We have ABS for the absolute value. We can select the minimum or the maximum value of different variables. We can calculate the average of some values. And we can create also random values between 0 and a value which we decide here. So here we have very many, many possibilities to create some logic here. Yeah, then we have time functions, starting with the now function, or we can return the actual day of the week, and yeah, many other time-based function. Usually this is used to compare different timestamps to determine how many time has passed between two actions, for example. Yeah, and last we have some text functions here. I also don't want to go too into details. You will also see this later in the examples, but in general it's of course also possible to combine text strings. We can shorten them, we can measuring the length of the text. So here we have also many possibilities for the control touch scripts. The last topic before we start with the examples are the control structures. So this is a quite important topic because we need this in almost all logic functions where we need a different behavior depending on the status of a group address. So in general, the setup is also very easy here. We have in general one condition, which is here in our example a variable called modular 3. And if this variable is 1, we set a bit to 1, and if not, we set a bit to 0. So where this is, well, where this comes from or where this could be useful, you will also see later in the examples. But in general, quite easy. We have always one variable which we compare, or where we say this must be 1 or 0 or bigger than 0 or smaller than 0. So here we can use, of course, all comparisons. Then we have the while command, for example, to execute a special command several times, so to repeat a certain action. This while statement will be activated as long as the condition is met. So we have here one condition. The condition is the dollar count variable is smaller than 10. And as long as this variable is smaller than 10, this command, which is the next line here, will be executed. Of course, here it would be also possible to create an endless while statement, so here you have to be a little bit careful. So for if, else and while, there is always one rule. I already mentioned it. Always the line after the statement will be executed. So in general, this is then one line, but of course in some situations we might need more than one command which should be executed. And for cases like this, we have the begin and the end statement. So with the begin statement, all lines after the begin will be executed. Or all lines after an if, of course, also. So very important if we want to execute more than one statement here. So in this case, all the three lines will be executed after the begin up to the end. Good, so this was basically all what is possible, so all commands, all possibilities which we have for scripts in a control touch. So of course it's not possible now to explain each command with an example in detail here, but in this online learning session we want to give you just an overview about what is possible here. Good, let's start then with the examples. Good, the first typical example could be a wake up light. So each morning we want to start the script with our wake up light so that I have a smooth and natural wake up light in my bedroom, for example. So here the script is running for 10 minutes and we have four steps in which we first dim the line to 10, then to 30, then to 50 and last to 100%. And I decided the time in which time this should happen, so how fast the light should rise here. So in general we can say here this is very useful if you want to create some functions or some behaviors of an actuator like the dimming actuator here, which is maybe not implemented in the application of the dimmer. Good, the second example is like, we can say like a scene for a dinner, a party, or what else. And here in this scene or in this script, we used some UPnP commands first of all. So in my example, I used Sonos UPnP. Of course, for me, it would be now easier to use the API of Sonos. But as I said, there are many other audio manufacturers which haven't where we haven't integrated the API, and then it might be useful to control these devices with our scripts here. So here I start to play two Sonos players here, and I set the volume to 20, for example. I could also select, for example, a certain playlist or skip songs or whatever I want. And next I created here like a light scene, so I switched some lights off, some on, and I faded the dimmer also to 20% maybe. So also a quite simple example, but I think a good and easy way to create some light scenes and some scenarios for your project. Okay, and last, a little bit, let's say a more complex use case or a more complex function or an example for a script. So we have the following use case. We want to decode the status information of the new combi switch actuator. So the actuator has one group object, which is called status information. And this is a one byte object, which is sent to the bus. And this byte consists, of course, of 8 bits, and each bit gives us an information. For example, the bit 0 gives us the information, is the manual operation active or inactive? The second bit gives us the information, is the device disabled or not? And so on. So each bit has one information about the status of the dimmer. And with a control touch script, we want to decode this status information now, and we want to make it visible on the control touch, of course. So what we need is, of course, first of all, the solution looks in the end like this. So we need a control touch page, which I called here fold messages. And on this page, I have now for each bit one group address, one bit group address for each bit. And I set these group addresses depending on the status information, which is sent from the actuator. I adjust the status of each bit we have here for the control touch. So the page is called fault messages. I also have one string here with the whole error code and the error code with the meaning of each bit you can see here. So how do we do this? How do we create a script for something like this? First of all, we start with the trigger. We need a condition first, and the condition is here that with each telegram which is sent to the group address fault message, so this is the group address from the status information from the actuator, we will start the script byte to bit. So as you see here, every telegram we start the script byte to bit. So this is how I named this script. So here you already see a part of the script, so it's quite complex, but before we have a closer look, or before we have a look at the details, let's have a look how the mathematical calculation works. So with this example, we have here the example that the actuator sends the one byte status information with the value 38, which would be on the KNX bus 26. So this is what you would see on the KNX bus here. For us, it's the real value 38 here. So in general, the calculation starts with the first value, which is 38, and we divide this value with 2, and we check if there is a rest or not. If not, the first bit is a 0. If yes, the bit is a 1. Then we divide again, so 19 divided by 2, and now here we would have the first rest because the result would be 18 and the rest would be Sorry, the result would be 9 and the rest would be here 1. So the second bit would be here the 1. So each mathematic calculation has now here its own block. So I have divided it a little bit with some comments to see in which block we are calculating which bit, which bit. And what you can also see here then is then with an is if else statement, I write then each group address bit to 1 if there is rest or to 0 if there is no rest. So this is what we do here to write really the group address, the status of the group address, the status of the bit to our visualization data. Okay, so let's have a little bit a closer look at the calculation here for the first two bits now. Then we have all the same behavior more or less. So again, we start with the value 38. We write this value first of all to a variable. And then we use the modulo function with 2. So modulo function means we are checking if this is divided by 2, if there is a rest or not. And then we write the result of the modulo function to the variable mod. So this is what you see here, what is marked here. We write the modulo function, the result to this variable. And then we check this variable if this is 1. So if there is a rest, we write a 1 to this bit. And if not, we write a 0 to this bit. So next, we divide our 38 with 2. What you can see here, and we floor this result so that we have a floored value and not a 19.5, for example, if the first value would be would have a rest. So then we create a new variable modulo 2. We calculate again the rest of the modulo 2 command, and again, if this is 1, then we write a 1, like in this case here. Or if not, then we would write a 0. Now we divide the 19 with 2 and we floor the result again so that we have 9 rest and so on for each bit. So this is the general process, what we do for each bit. Here I show you, of course, only a part of the script. Yeah, and this is then the end of the script. So what do I do here? In the end of the script, I want to write the whole error string now. So we write for each bit the value and use the substring function. We have to use it because, like you can see here, this is a screenshot from the data logger. The values are stored as 1.0000, and we only need really the first number, so the 1 or the 0 for the bits. So this is the reason why we have to use the substring function here for each bit. And then in the end, we combine all bits with the concat function, which can be used to combine text components. And first we write our text group address, which is visible here with the whole code. And we also send an alarm to our mobile devices, which also contains the contains the alarm message. So this is then first of all the string. This is visible here in the application later on, the error code 00100110, and this is the alert which I have called with the script. And as soon as there is a change from the status information from the actuator, I will get a notification to my mobile phone also, which contains the error message. Okay, so this would be one practical example how we could use scripts to decode the status information. So I hope I could give you now some impressions about the scripts in the Control Touch. Of course, it's always recommended to learn this whole stuff by playing with the scripts. So as you see, it's really like a small programming language, and this you can really only learn by trying out some functions, test it, play with it. So here but are definitely a lot of possibilities. Good, so thank you for listening, and I think I can hand back to Thorsten now.
Yeah, thank you, Martin. Yeah, we have seen right now a further powerful function of the Bush Control Touch, the scripts. So in principle, yeah, a text-oriented individual programming is here possible. And I think many of you know our logic controller ABAS, also a component to program something, but in a graphical way with function blocks. So this so-called function block diagram programming. There is mainly classical logic and time and mathematical functions inside. Also some functions like controller, so PID controller you can program. There is of course an overlapping also to the scripts of the control touch. But in my opinion, we have the control touch a bit more options, more flexibility. Think about these special control structure elements like if else, while, or these execute commands to connect any network devices. So a bit more flexibility to integrate any external components as well. So I remember from our trainings that from time to time customers were asking for such text-oriented programming. So, but now we have it available in our KNIC system. I take the presenter ball to show you my final typical slides. Yeah, you find everything around the product on our homepage, as you know. We have our training database where we store later also this session for anybody. But of course, you get also direct link with our feedback email, both the video and the presentation. Our training qualification calendar a bit less than normal because we have no classroom trainings at the moment. The next time, so only our online learning sessions, webinars are inside the calendar. At the moment we have no classroom trainings. Also this month in July we planned originally our advanced certified course. Not possible. We are still optimistic to continue maybe after the summer period with classroom trainings in Heidelberg and anywhere else, also in Lüdenscheid. We will see what is possible. Absolutely open at the moment, but we will inform you if something is happening there, of course. But nevertheless, we are continuing with our online offers like the webinars, and we continue next week with a further webinar about our KNX LED dimmer, the UDS. There is an extension in the range. There are already existing some components, but we have now further new components, different in power. 315 watt is now available and also different in functions. So this will be next week on Wednesday, the 8th of July. And the online learning session, next one will be in 2 weeks. And we will continue with another exciting product, also a multi-purpose component, the IoT dashboard server. We would like to start with a kind of guidance around the initial commissioning of this device and the first steps. But I'm pretty sure that we will continue with some more sessions around this product because there's also a lot of functionality inside. Yeah, if you have any other ideas for online learning sessions, you can give us a feedback either to our email it's directly or to the training email you see here on the slide. Okay, still no questions at the moment. So then I would say thank you for your participation. Wait for our feedback email. Still in the evening, you get the PDF at least. And hope to see you next time again. Thank you. See you. Bye-bye. Ciao.